because I think that 2 years ago, we talked a lot about always on publicists, but I think we're kind of moving a little bit away from that structure, because at the end of the day, do you always want to be on with some of these brands? Or, I mean, we'd be aiming for always right. And what that means is that sometimes you're gonna have to sacrifice keeping quiet. You're not gonna trend jack. You're not gonna be moved by the fact that everybody else is co-opting a particular cultural event. So, I mean, I think to some degree, the always on thing from a listening and intelligence standpoint is absolutely critical, but always on in terms of execution, in terms of engagement, I mean, it gets really exhausting. And I don't necessarily think that it's particularly now with sort of much more consumer empowerment and the reality of the fact that, you know, not every brand needs to be entertainment and needs to be completely social and embedded in every part of our lives. So, you know, I think it's about being very, very strategically minded and precise about how you use an always on platform. They are particularly in terms of content strategy or what have you. I mean, you know, obviously there's more pressure on being hyper relevant, you know, hyper context, hyper everything, right? Where it is really exact. And clearly, I mean, the nice thing that's happened now is that if they do require you, people are technologically adept enough, they're gonna find you, okay? So it's not necessarily that we need to be, you know, absolutely everywhere, but if you are in the right context, I'll give you an example. We work with, you know, Vicks, and obviously it's a cold fluid treatment drug and medicine. And what happens is basically if we understand that obviously the fluid was in a particular DNA or what have you, if we push out content at that moment when somebody is starting to feel the very early symptoms, it's a very, very relevant piece, especially with a little bit of attitude, right? So, you know, that's what we kind of call hyper-context, like digging really, really deep into when it's actually going to be meaningful. And again, mass has become kind of more niche in a weird way, right? I think that we try to do that across the board, particularly because there's so much temptation and no lack of creativity to create different kinds of content at all times. Because it's an easier translation to the billion conversations or the utility or the extensions of value that come from the brand these days. So I think that I hate the idea that the good idea is dead. I mean, that kind of kills me inside a little bit. Also because, you know what, there are some universal things out there that we all still kind of, a movie is an idea, and a movie can have incredible mass appeal. So, you know, I think that it's just that the way that it's articulated now, it's embedded with purpose, it's embedded with social potential,
We're asking them. The big idea of just put it in front of a bunch of people on the whole works. It has to be some nimbleness and some agility to it. It has to be able to be identified by channel.
Data that, for us anyway, when we're creating our strategies, behavioral data is really, really sort of a priority, because we've been living for years in sort of pretend, self-regulated kind of data or what people's perceptions are. So that's really important. But I think we capture so much that the whole craft of insight is really at the heart of what's going to make data valuable. And I would say that as an industry, there are incredible best practices at it, but at the pace that things are changing, at the greed and incredible thirst for just collection, that it gets overwhelming. And so sometimes, you know, that incision of actual analysis and insight, I think is lost. The good fortune of having clients that recognize that come to us and basically say, hey, you know, help us transform from point A to point Z. So, you know, for us to be able to do that, we ourselves have to be in a position to understand what the different innovative models are that are out there. Now, anybody knows what that will look like. All you can do is set yourself up in a nimble enough, flexible way so that when it does set, you're ready. Buddy's question or story. Interestingly enough, we get clients that sometimes come to us and say, hey, everyone, we need a campaign to do
once you analyze the challenge and the business opportunity, we kind of say, you don't need advertising, you need product innovation. And guess what? You have enough of a fan base to do this. That's where strategy plays. You know, we don't see the tools, certainly not within our agency, we don't see the tools of advertising to be classic advertising tools. They're problem-solving tools. So for us, product innovation that goes through, you know, sort of an advocacy model is as legitimate a marketing strategy as a big TV campaign that launches in the Super Bowl. And second that, in terms of that T model and sort of the notion that you need to have the fundamentals across business strategy, sort of brand and consumer, real insight and engagement strategy, but also knowing that you do need a specialist, like a something that you're really passionate about. I always call my planners and my strategists as having superpowers. You gotta find your superpower, right? And then the second thing that I always look for is somebody who's, you know, passionate about something. Like one, you know, be culturally voracious about something. I don't care whether it's music, I don't care how niche it is, right? But it says to me, it says to people that you have the ability, because we live in such a place where we're always trying to fuel fandom. So I think people that don't have the depth of understanding and experience of knowing what it feels to be obsessive and love something and want to be part of it, there's nuance in that experience that makes you a really good strategist.